Hello everybody, my name's Ben Robbins from the Lost World of Movie Props and I'm here today with the original Stormtrooper, Chris Bunn. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
Awesome, yeah. Are you enjoying yourself today?
Yeah, lovely area and great venue.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Awesome, it's your first time at the Screen Signers as well?
It is Screen Signers' first one.
Yeah,
it's awesome. Their first one, yeah.
Yeah, it's been quite busy this morning, hasn't it?
Yeah, we ticked over, yeah, very good. Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about your career. When did you first start acting?
I first started in 1969.
Yeah.
My first film was a carry-on film. Carry On Again, Doctor, I think it was.
Nice.
Yes.
How did you get the role for that one?
I fitted the bill and the agent just sends you down to the studio and you just turn up at 8 o'clock in the morning sort of thing, that's it.
Nice. Yeah. Easy day then sort of thing.
Yeah.
Brilliant. So let's talk a bit about Star Wars, because we're here because it's a Star Wars event today.
Yeah.
So how did you get involved with Star Wars?
Exactly the same thing. Agent, you fit the bill. The costume was actually moulded on me.
Yeah.
And I went to somebody 5'11 and slimish.
Yeah.
To go down into the domain of plaster cast on my body, and that was it.
So how did they make the plaster cast on your body for the Stormtrooper?
I literally shaved my body. with a blunt bick.
Nice.
I literally shaved my body and then just smeared plaster all over me.
Yeah.
That's it. So like, I lay on the table, dead still for an hour or so.
Really? Oh,
wow. To set it. Then they just took it off.
Nice. Awesome. So was it all from the neck downwards pretty much?
Yeah. If you look at a Stormtrooper, apart from the helmet and the boots, the rest of it is me.
Nice. Awesome, because you're also one of the first Stormtroopers on set and in the first shots and everything.
I was the very first Stormtrooper to walk on set, yeah.
So do you remember what it was like when you first went on to set and started shooting?
We said, well, what's all this about? It's like cowboys and Indians in spacesuits.
Nice.
We thought it was a load of rubbish. We didn't realise it was going to be, obviously, what was good. And George Lucas was actually doing it on a very small budget, then he went to Hollywood, cap in hand, come back with a few more quid, and the rest is history,
yeah,
as they say.
So what was it like having George Lucas direct you? Was he quite harsh, or was he quite easygoing?
Well, me personally, I didn't get directed by George Lucas, because most of the stuff I'd done were the action scenes.
Yeah.
And they have what they call a second unit, which actually, they direct the action scenes and the battle scenes and things like that.
Yeah.
And they're called the director is actually an expert in battle scenes.
That's, oh,
nice. that's what he that does. So it's a sort of like separate unit. I see George around, you know, there's always morning George and things like that, but I never actually got directed by him.
Nice. So did you get to have any of the pyro go off on you when you got hit by the laser guns and everything, or was that all done by stuntmen?
No, I got killed 6 times. Yeah, but no, I mean, it was, if you run in, when you hit that mark, sort of thing, go down.
Yeah.
That's what was telling us.
Brilliant.
But so if we had to go down, we had to change the suits from the plastic ones into rubber suits.
Oh, okay, yeah.
You had to put the stunt suits on, because they're made of rubber, and obviously it didn't hurt itself.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, and you don't obviously crack the plastic on the plastic ones and cost
exactly,
money.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly, that's it as well.
So, and what were the Stormtrooper guns made out of? Were they rubber guns as well? Were they real guns?
No, they were real guns. It was actually British Army issue Sterling submachine guns.
Awesome, nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, obviously, they were being deactivated and they couldn't be really fire good, though.
Well, no, it wasn't deactivated because they had to fire blanks.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they fire blanks.
Oh, wow,
yeah.
Nice. That's really cool. So you could still fire. So did you get to fire lots of blanks on set?
Yeah, I fired quite a few. They're the hardcore people actually firing the guns. And the rest of them had mock-up wooden ones.
Yeah.
But then we had what would they call practical guns.
Yeah.
So I think about 10 of us, I think. And they chose me to do that because I've been in the TA and I was weapons trained anyway. So.
Oh, wicked. Nice.
Yeah.
So obviously COVID's sort of all settled down now, all shows are back open. Have you had a busy year so far?
No, it's been very quiet at the moment.
Yeah.
It's been very quiet, but I've got through about 4 or 5 more to do between, I'm booked for 4 or 5 more between now and Christmas. Mm. Hopefully some more come up.
Yeah, awesome. So are you happy for people to book you if they want for events, if they see this, just to contact you on Facebook or?
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
Awesome. Brilliant. Well, I'll let you get back to your day, Chris, and I hope you're having a good one.
Okay,
and
thanks very much.
Enjoy meeting the fans.
All right, yeah, okay, Ben. All right, see you soon.
Yep.
Hello, everybody. My name's Ben Robbins from The Lost World of Movie Props. I'm here today with David Stone. How are you doing, sir?
I'm fine, Ben. How are you?
I'm very good, thank you. So, are you enjoying yourself today? You've been busy?
Yeah, I mean, not too bad. I mean, what can you say? Yeah. It's been all right. Waiting for the rush.
Yeah, of course. So, did you always want to be an actor growing up, or did you fall into the roles?
I went to drama school, and after that, I was coming to the end of drama school, and then they were doing an audition at Elstree for this first Star Wars, A New Hope.
Yeah.
And A New Hope entailed wearing a rubber head, which I think you know.
Yeah.
You see me in that head. They called it the actual head, the multi-eyed creature.
Mm.
And if you see the head, you know why,
because yeah,
it's got about 10 eyes and tentacles either side,
yeah,
blah blah blah. And then when Lucas realized what was going on, because this was A New Hope, the first one ever made, he then decided to give us all contracts and character names,
yeah,
because those heads were just, you know, not, like I said, a multi-eyed creature. So I was given the name of Wyostley, which was a very strange name. And this was the one that involved the land speeder being sold.
Yeah.
When we went to Tunisia in the desert. I expect you've seen that scene.
Yeah, of course.
And which was very nice, very hot. The mask head, it was a head really. It just fitted over. It was like a rubber head that went straight over your head.
Mm.
I had a mold done for it. It was most uncomfortable. The holes at the front, I used to put a couple of straws up to have a drink.
Nice.
Because you couldn't keep taking the head off in between shots. It was just so difficult. So basically, we had it on for about 4 or 5 hours.
Oh, wow.
So it was miserable.
Mm.
Sweat used to be dripping underneath, you can imagine, most uncomfortable. And then, of course, in the cantina scene where we were all in the disco, you can imagine with all the smoke, you know, because they had all smoke, you know, special effects, with the head, smoke, heat, it was just unbearable, and you couldn't wait for 1 o'clock to, because you used to go in 6 o'clock call in the morning. And then usually have it on 4 or 5 hours, and then break for lunch.
Yeah.
Then of course you took it off, back again 2 o'clock, same old rigmarole. But it was it was good fun. There was a lot of the small people there as well.
Yeah.
Kenny Baker and some of the others. Of course Dave Prowse has gone now, and the other one, Bullock, Jeremy Bullock. And then of course when that came to an end, A New Hope, he then was doing two others, back to back. He basically did, then he went on to Return of the Jedi and then Empire Strikes Back, which he gave me a couple of small parts on that. As a B-wing, I was a B-wing in Return of the Jedi, and then doubled also for Mark Hamill in a couple of scenes while Mark was away. I mean, I was stuck up in a spaceship in Elstree, sort of 40 foot up in the air in one of the hangars.
Awesome.
I mean, it was pretty good because the orange, you know, when you're that far away, you can double for anyone. So Mark was in Los Angeles, and I suppose I looked a bit similar to him, and so they kept me up there for that. And then for some reason, you know, we were like a little Star Wars family, because then he kept the people who were in that one to go on to Empire.
Yeah.
And then I was an X-wing in Empire Strikes Back. Most of them were all done in the UK, Elstree. Elstree studio. A lot of people think that Star Wars is American.
Yeah, yeah, I've heard that so many times from people. Yeah. It's crazy.
But it does get the impression for some reason it is American, but it's not. But of course, the franchise now has been taken over by Disney. Yeah. So I suppose that's why a lot of people automatically think that it was made in America. But in fact, it was all made to the credit of the British film industry in the UK.
Yeah.
In Elstree, and there's bits and pieces done in location, and then Tunisia, and so that's basically where I did a few other bits and pieces after Star Wars, and was the best man at Brigitte Bardot, and then I worked on The Stud with Joan Collins.
Wicked, nice.
Bun?
That's really cool, yeah, with Joan Collins,
You watched it?
I haven't seen it for a while, but I remember seeing it, yeah.
And then I sort of came out of that business, and I did work on behind the scene. I worked as a location manager for the BBC after that, excuse me, and then got made redundant and then moved to the West Country. I thought, well, what shall I do now with my life? So I bought a holiday complex in Devon, which I've since sold.
Yeah.
And moved back to the southeast, and therefore it's enabled me to do a tickle in my throat.
Sorry. I've got some water down there if you want some water.
It's enabled me now to do the comic conventions, which I've been doing the last 3 or 4 years all over the world.
Oh, wow. Nice.
You know, I've been doing them a lot in America, Canada, Europe. And anybody who's had anything to do with Star Wars is really sought after, because there's such a big following for it. That's the thing. And you admire the people that follow it, because you think, well, if it makes them happy, why not?
Yeah.
And there's nothing wrong. You know, everyone's just got to get pleasure out of life somewhere. And if following Star Wars, you know, people, the characters, it's good. So...
Hello, everybody. My name's Ben Robbins from The Lost World of Movie Props. I'm here today with Mike Edmonds. How are you doing, sir?
I'm fine, thanks. Yeah, fine. So yeah. Enjoying myself.
Yeah, you had a good day today?
Not bad. Not bad, yeah. It's always lovely meeting people and fans, of course, yeah.
Yeah, of course. So let's talk about Star Wars. You were in Star Wars.
Yeah, I was in 2 Star Wars, Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi.
Awesome. And so you played a Wookiee. No.
Ewok.
Ewok, sorry. I just spoke to a Wookiee, that's why. You play an Ewok. So how did you get the role to be an Ewok in Star Wars?
Well, through being in Empire Strikes Back, I played one of the Ugnaughts in that, and various other bits and pieces. And Robert Watts liked what I did, and he remembered me, and that's how I got into Return of the Jedi.
Yeah. So what was it like playing a obviously... with so many other people, like obviously like yourself, dwarfs.
Yeah.
Was it like all getting to work together? Because obviously, compared to nowadays, it wasn't so much known, obviously.
No, it's a great introduction to some of the little guys, because I've never acted before. So it was a good introduction to them to know what it's like to film, you know, long hours and the stresses and strains of working in costumes and tight costumes and things like this. And, so we had 2 lots. One lot of there was main Ewoks, you know, like Warwick Davis and myself, Jack Purvis Kelly, and then there was just a general crowd Ewoks.
Yeah.
So we had 1 lot when we filmed in England at the studio, and then we went to America to film the Redwood Forest, and that's what we had another lot from America. So
oh wow, nice.
There was made a lot of new friends.
Yeah, brilliant. So what was the wardrobe like to wear? Was it quite hot and tight, or was it quite comfortable?
No, it's very uncomfortable, really, because especially when we're in the Redwood Forest, because it's very humid there in California. Actually, the Redwood Forest was, we stayed in Oregon, but went across the border to California to film the Redwood Forest.
Yeah.
So it was very humid, in the forests and stuff like this, and there was 3 layers of costume.
Oh wow.
One One was like a pajama suit goes to, next to our skin.
Yeah.
Then on the top of that went all the lumps and the bumps of a, you know, a Ewok's physique.
Yeah.
And then on top of that went the fur.
Yeah.
And the last thing that went on was the head.
Yeah.
And now that come on and off. But the main problem they had with the head was the eyes steaming up.
Yeah.
The eyes kept steaming up, us sweating, and you know, making the inside of the eyes mist up. So they tried to come up with several ideas, but the one they stuck with was putting washing up liquid on the inside.
Oh,
and
wow.
That sort of solved it, yeah. Yeah.
So what was it like filming all the battle scenes? Because you're in quite a few scenes where there was lots of explosions.
Oh,
and
yeah, there was lots of stuff like that. There were separate groups, you know, they went through to teach them that part and things like that. Luckily, I didn't have to do anything of that too much. So I just commanded everybody and threw a few orders about.
Yeah. So you've mentioned your first two characters. Who was your third character you played?
Sorry, third character was the tail end of Jabba the Hutt.
Oh, nice, wicked.
Yeah, there was three of us in there. But, yeah. You know, there was me doing the tail, and then two guys doing one arm, and the other guys doing the other arm.
Yeah. So was it all like animated inside? Did you have levers to pull? Or how?
No, I just had, it was a big thing. Similar to a handle on a motorbike, the throttle control, yeah. Going right out to the tail, and that was sort of floating, so it wasn't heavy or anything like that, you yeah. know. And then I had a TV monitor like this, and I could see what was happening outside through the eye of the camera, what was in vision. And as it was the tail, if the tail came into view, I had to, you know, manipulate the tail.
Yeah.
And this went on, depending on what temperament, I've got his name now, he was, you know, whether he was in a temper or he was lovey-dovey and things like that.
Yeah.
You do it like that. And I thought about our cat, what we used to have at the time, you know.
Yeah.
And how he'd be, if he was in a temper, the tail would thrash a bit more. You knew he was going to either scratch or bite you or, you know, things like that. So, yeah. So it worked out well.
Yeah. Because I read online that when you were in the suit, you were obviously feeding the other actors and people sweets.
Oh, yeah,
and
when I was inside Jabba, because I was in normal clothes, you know, just sat there and seeing things through the monitor. And we had sweets and stuff like this. And so I'd wrap sweet, give them that and stuff, you know, because all I could see was their backsides, you know, because they were operating, you know, throwing themselves around and things like that. So. Yeah. I'd pass them up to the drink, bottle of drink if they had one, you know, and things like this. Yeah.
Yeah, wonderful.
But I was quite comfortable.
So you enjoyed yourself today? Has it been nice meeting the
lovely.
Fans?
Yeah, I always do enjoy the club in meeting the fans, you know. Because as I always say, without them, we're nothing.
Yeah.
You know, it's only them that, you know, makes us.
Yeah, of course.
And it's lovely to know. When you think how long... this film, yeah, how long ago this film was out?
Yeah,
and they're still, yeah, children coming along, you know, fun, yeah, love it, yeah.
Yeah, people are raising their kids on it now,
well,
still.
That's right, and they dress up and things like that, and yeah, it's lovely.
Yeah, awesome.
And I'm honoured to do it. Yeah, I'm glad they still remember me.
Brilliant. Well, thank you so much for talking to me. It was just a quick little talk today.
Yeah, that's fine. And that's fine.
I hope you enjoy the rest of your day and meet some more people.
Well, yeah.
Hello, everybody. My name's Ben Robbins from The Lost World of Movie Props. I'm here today with Ross Sambridge. How are you doing?
I'm very well, thank you. How are you doing?
I'm very good, thank you. So, Ross, this is your first event you've put on?
Yes. Back in January, I was chatting to Paul Cotsgrove, who's the film festival director for Southend, and I asked him, has there ever been a Comic-Con in Southend? And he said, well, no, there's not been much call for one because we've got MCM and other places nearby. And I said, well, the South End is fast becoming a hub of film and TV.
Yeah.
And there's so many actors and other things in the area that what's stopping someone putting on a Comic-Con?
Yeah, of course.
So I went away, had a think about it, and then I advised the well, the South End's very first Comic Con, and Screen Sunners by the Sea came alive.
Nice, awesome. So did you come up with the name yourself for it, or did you spitball with people?
I kind of wanted it to rhyme with like ice cream by the sea.
Okay, yeah, right? Nice.
So, and it's the fact that we like work on a screen and we signers, and it's in the parking, which is by the sea, so it was Screen Signers by the Sea.
Yeah.
And the actual design, with what I'm wearing, like the... with like the curves all there and the seagulls and having the film reel because that is actually supposed to be like the pier.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
So I thought it was quite good. So I kind of designed that and put all the pictures, posters, and everything up together. Yeah. And then it was the only simple case of getting the signers to come. Yeah. So myself and Chris Bunn, we wanted to get some local signers, you know, maybe a couple of people a bit further afield as well, and they were very happy to say yes, and I can't thank them enough.
Yeah, because you've had quite a busy day today. I mean, this morning we have people queuing up, they come in, you've had lots of people at different tables.
Yeah,
it's been really successful today.
Well, thank you very much indeed. It's up until 10 o'clock I was still thinking is this going to actually work, is anyone going to turn up?
Yeah.
And then as soon as the first customer came in, I was like, okay, that's good. Maybe then when it's keep coming in and minning in, and of course, like waves, they were low, a bit low. It's now picked up a little bit more now. So I'm really happy. I'm the fact that this is the biggest thing I've ever organised.
Yeah.
And you know, it's not been completely smooth.
Yeah.
But then this is the first one, so it's a bit of a learning curve.
Of course, yeah, everything is.
But for next time, and it will be come back. Screen Signers by Sea 2023 will be happening.
Yep.
And we'll know what's good.
Yeah. Of course.
A lot of people have said that they think it's a fantastic idea and wondered why it's not been done before. So, but now we can put Southend's Comic Con on the map.
Oh, brilliant! Yeah. So you're going to look to just stay mainly this area. You're going to venture out a little bit further afield.
Well,
or...
Along the sea front, because then I can have the by the sea.
Yeah,
I can't put it by the sea, just inland.
No, of course.
I would like to continue around this area, maybe possibly like slightly further afield. I don't know, but definitely down the beach front.
Yeah, of course.
In the confines of Southend and nearby towns, definitely.
Brilliant.
So
awesome.
I think Southend deserves to have its Comic Con. And it's just awesome that this is taking place. When I was told that there was a Dalek coming, I was like, really? And as I see it doing its thing outside, and I did want to have it on the pier. Really did, but unfortunately it rained, didn't it?
I did say to you, you should go put it near one of the roller coasters in the line, so it looks like it's queuing up for a ride or something.
But I think in the rain it might get its donated itself. maybe in the Wurzel. Quite nice, the Wurzel. Yeah, but all in all, it's been a good day. We've got a couple more hours yet.
Yeah.
And we'll see what happens. But
of course,
ecstatic that it's things have been well. I mean, I'll probably come home and have a little rest, I think.
Let the brain sizzle down a little bit and
just a bit. Yeah, cool.
So should we talk a little bit about Star Wars, because you're in Star Wars?
Apparently so, yeah.
So
that little one,
you're in was that The Last Jedi?
Yes, that's right. The Last Jedi, and then in Solo.
So who was your character in The Last Jedi, and what role did you play?
Well, I was the physical body of Supreme Leader Snoke.
Nice, awesome.
Andy Serkis was the voice, but the actual, like the body frame and how it, when it was walking, is all me. They did a molding of my hands and my part of my face.
Yeah,
and with my body all around, they just blended it all together. A little bit like a more of a futuristic. How they did Darth Vader, with James Earl Jones being the voice and Dave Prowse being the body. So that in that sense. But Andy and I were given free rein of how Snoke would move.
Yeah.
So we, because in The Force Awakens, you don't see him in a flesh, you see him as a hologram. So Ryan Johnson, the director of Jedi, said, you play around with the character, see what works. But we knew that he was going to be... slightly falling apart, should we say.
Yeah.
A bit pretty decrepit. But so we went with that basis. But yeah, it, what's on screen is pretty much how we device it would be.
Yeah. So did you get to put a lot of your own input into how you thought he would move and act?
Well, yes. The thing is, I've got a slight curvature of the spine.
Yeah.
And they're, because of that, it added to Snoke. So it was like, because I could like a loom over and be all menacing and creepy, but still be caught like, you know, on the last legs.
Yeah.
So I just played around how he would walk, and things change over the course of the production. But in a way, the gold robes was a character in themselves, because it was all dark reds and blacks as a muted background. Then the gold really shows up his like royal status.
Yeah.
So that's sort of what the eyeline features on. So I guess if they had a shorter person playing him, it wouldn't work so well.
Yeah, of course.
So when I walked down the slope to break Kylo Ren and to take the mask off and everything else, it was the emphasis on that part. Yes, he's falling apart, but he's still very much a powerful figure, powerful presence.
So how tall are you? Like, because obviously I've stood next to you and you tower over me, and but I'm 5'11".
I'm 7'1".
You're 7'1"?
Yeah.
Wow, that's mental. Like. So, I mean, obviously because you're so tall, do you get offered a lot of big roles for playing tall characters, or is Star Wars your main sort of break?
Yeah, I mean, I do. I've done a lot of creatures and aliens and monsters. And
nice.
Things, and I don't mind doing that because it's like I'm not very good at basketball. So I thought, well, I'll use my hat to help, and it helps certain creatures come alive. And,
brilliant.
Yeah. And that's went on to do Solo.
Yeah, Solo. You're in Solo as well. You were a Wookiee in Solo.
Yeah, so and a Wookiee was literally a dream come true. I got to work with the late Peter Mayhew back in 2007.
Nice. Yeah.
The 30th anniversary of Star Wars. I was living in Bristol, and they were putting on this show, The Heroes and Villains. And they popped into this memorabilia shop who's hosting it. And they just said that Peter was coming down, and his wife Angie was there, and Kenny Baker, and I said, would I be interested in dressing up as Chewbacca? It's a bit like a cosplay.
Yeah, of course.
It took me all of a second to say yes, and on the day the costume came, and I put it on, and I was like, wow, here I am, I'm gonna be a Wookiee. But then during the course of the day, Peter called me over to his signing table, if you like, and said, look, I see you walking around, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to teach you how to walk like Chewbacca, hold the bowcaster like Chewbacca, and to roar like Chewbacca. So I had a masterclass from the man himself.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Yeah. So I was like, I was dumbfounded. I was like, wow, this is brilliant. So, I thought if that's as close as I'm going to come to being on Star Wars, I'm still going to die a happy man.
Yeah, of course.
And then 10 years later, I'm doing it for real. Mm. And part of Star Wars lore on the Kessel, might escape and everything. And I think I had three highlights on that particular production. The first one was, well, obviously getting the role.
Yeah.
Secondly, seeing the Millennium Falcon for the first time.
Nice.
And so myself and the other three Wookiee actors, I believe that we asked them to take our paws off so we could just touch the main Falcon. And the crew's going, it's made out of wood and stuff.
Yeah.
But to us, it doesn't matter. It's the actual Falcon. And
to
do it. And we can say, yep, now we can die.
Yeah.
And probably the third highlight was just every single second of each day was a happy smile on my face. Nothing bad happened. I mean, yes, there was instances where things could have happened, but no, it was just amazing to be surrounded by the likes of Woody Harrelson and Amelia Clark, and then being directed by Ron Howard.
Yeah, of course.
You know, so it's just I didn't want it to stop.
Yeah,
end at all. It's just brilliant.
Yeah, sounds awesome. I mean, I know you just had some more people go into your room that are coming to meet you today. So it was just a quick little talk for us to do today.
No, that's fine. I mean, Well, I will say is that Peter did tell me how to actually roar.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, he said that people do it out of, his, out of their mouths, but it's actually out of their noses.
Oh, is it?
So, yeah. So he said, you put your tongue down their back and throw a little bit. Don't choke the
death.
No. And then it's all they all shaking their head. And, yeah, so, and we all did that on the set. And Ron really liked the fact that it wasn't just actors playing Wookiees, it was actually like Wookiees on set.
Yeah.
And we were both communicating each other and, you know.
So you kind of got your own language going as Wookiees.
Yeah. So, yeah.
That sounds fantastic. It sounds like probably one of the best roles and jobs you can have.
As I say, I didn't want it to end. And who knows what might happen in the future.
Yeah, of course. Well, we hope to see you again on the bigger screen in the future, like, definitely. Well,
thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
And thank you so much for talking to me. I'll let you get back to running your event and enjoying the rest of your day.
Cheers. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name's Ben Robbins from The Lost World of Movie Props, and this is round two for us because my sound quality has just gone completely haywire for some reason. So how are you guys doing, and how's your day been?
Yeah, it's been great. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's been good. Terrorised people in the Dalek, so nice. It's been lots of fun.
Awesome. So because you guys are obviously professional cosplayers, because you do this full time. So tell us what a cosplayer is and what you're doing in your outfit and what you're doing here today.
Basically, we started doing this just over a year ago. I'm autistic and my partner comes along to help me dress up, and she also dresses up herself, but majority of the time it's to help me suit up.
Yeah,
because I struggle getting into some of the costumes.
Cool. So what costumes have you got?
Today I've been doing Mandalorian earlier on. Yeah. And now I'm a Jedi.
Sweet. So obviously with your Jedi costume you got on, is it all handmade? Do you buy this in?
Like... this was all handmade, but it was handmade by a friend of mine called Kevin in Wales.
Oh, wonderful. I mean, how much time it must go into make something like this? I mean, did it take a matter of weeks or was it months?
I'm not sure. I would have thought it took a long time, yeah, especially by the thickness of the materials.
Awesome. Brilliant. So what kind of cosplays do you do?
I do mostly Star Wars. Yeah. I've got Rey, Second Sister from Fallen Order.
Nice.
We have an array of lightsabers.
Yeah.
We're part of a saber group, so yeah.
Nice. So what's a saber group? Explain that to us and tell us about that.
Basically, it's a martial arts group, but with lightsabers.
Yeah.
And we do the seven different forms of Jedi fighting.
Wonderful.
It is good fun. Plus, we spar as well.
Yeah.
So get to fight each other, so it's even better.
So it's real full contact sparring, these lightsabers and that.
Yeah.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
So
you can hurt each other.
You can hurt each other, good and proper. So do you two fight each other? Is it like good counselling for you two? Like to beat the crap out of each other, some lightsabers?
I don't know. We went to Glastonbury a few weeks back and we took the lightsabers with us and we had a good spar in the grounds there.
Nice.
Yeah, we had fun.
Awesome. So obviously you've got a lightsaber in front of us.
Yep.
I mean, these things, do they cost hundreds of pounds or can you get them quite reasonable
some
prices?
Of them do. They can be up to £1,000,
sometimes
pounds. Even more. It depends who's made them, what's inside them.
Yeah.
Has it got a crystal chamber and what's the blade made out of? So yeah, there's a lot of variables, but this one is about £150. It's from Padawan Outpost. This is the pixel blade, so
nice.
The blade will do quite a few different bits.
Yeah, let's have a look.
There you go, it's a multicolour light, so it shows you how many LEDs are in there.
Yeah, it's good and proper. And it goes up and down as you turn it on and off. It's so cool, isn't it? It's a proper boys grown up toy, isn't it? So you were just saying you're outside terrorising kids. Explain a bit more to that, how you mean you were terrorising kids.
Well, I get to be in a Dalek.
Oh, awesome.
Drive it around and shout in a Dalek voice at people, and I get away with it.
Nice. So you've got a full working Dalek with you. Like, is it made out, is it fiberglass or is it wood or metal? How did you make it and where did you get it from?
Well, we were looking for a while for a Dalek. At Christmas time, she said to me, I want a Dalek, and she never asked for anything, so I knew it was something she really wanted.
Yeah.
We tried to look for fiberglass kits. There was a couple on eBay, but by the time we got the money and we were ready to purchase, they weren't on there no more, and they haven't been on there since. We've just been hunting, looking for Dalek around the right price, found one. Unfortunately, it was in Cornwall.
Yeah.
So, yeah, long trip over to go and get it, and then we find out that it was originally from Norfolk, so...
Yeah.
We're pretty much bringing it home because we're just on the Norfolk border.
Nice, perfect. So you can drive it about, and like, is it all remote controlled or is it hand controlled how you drive
it? Right, it's a modified wheelchair, motorized wheelchair on a custom frame. It's got four electrics in there. It runs off three different batteries.
Yeah.
It's got what's called a Mark mod, which will change your voice. It will make your dome lights flash, and you can also fire the gun and scare people that way.
Oh, so some real commitment goes into cosplay. I don't think people realise just how much goes into it.
Yeah.
So does it take up most of your year doing this?
Do you know, it actually has.
Yeah.
most of the winter downtime, it's like I thought, well, last year I was in the Stormtrooper, there was a built one, and I decided I was going to buy my own kit and build one myself. Well, it took about 3 months.
Oh, and that's
most days going at it. So yeah, it takes a lot longer than people realise.
I mean, because cosplay now, it's so big now in the UK, and you've almost made like your own community and friends. Have you made more friends and almost family now doing this?
Do you know, we've met so many people, not just other cosplayers, people like actors as well. Mm. So you just meet a variety of people, and then the next time you go to an event, they wave at you, they remember who you are. Yeah, it's great.
You become friends with them.
Yeah exactly. Yeah. I mean, all the stars today here, as soon as you guys walked in, they were giving you big hugs and saying hi to you.
Yeah, Ross and Chris and Pam. Everyone recognises you. Yeah.
So who can book you? Can anyone book you to come up to their events? Would you do charity events to help people out?
Do you know, if there's a charity event on and it's local, we'd like to be there.
Yeah.
That's probably the most important thing, is raising money for good causes.
Yeah.
Second of all, is having fun dressing up.
Of course, yeah. Because when we spoke firstly, you said it was your granddad who inspired you to do this.
It was.
So tell us a bit about your granddad, what he did, because he actually had an awesome career.
Yeah, he did. Yeah. He was an actor. He was also a stunt double. He was Lee Marvin's stunt double,
because
had really bad lungs. Yeah. So there's my granddad running on top of the train and stuff like that. Yeah, he was Roger Moore's stunt double in the 007 movies as well.
Yeah.
Quite a few films, the old Batman, Flash Gordon, also in Eagle Comics as well.
Yeah,
so he's had quite a career, but he died of lung cancer 3 years ago, and this is my way of getting over that bit of the grief.
Yeah,
just getting it out.
I mean, of
and
course,
it feels good.
I mean, he's obviously such a badass, because what people don't realise, that stunt people you see so much through films.
Yeah.
So to have that as well behind him, not just obviously being on screen, but to be able to say that he did all the cool stunts, because a lot of things now, a lot of CGI happens nowadays, but back then they were running through fire and stuff.
Yeah.
So it's a real cool thing to say.
Not many actors did their own stunts.
No.
I've got some pictures from one of the Dirty Dozen films where they actually rolled a truck.
Nice.
And he's standing there taking pictures, and he's right beside this thing while it rolls.
Yeah, it's fantastic. So you guys are going to be here much longer today? You're staying for the whole day?
Yeah, we're going to be here for the whole day.
Yeah, awesome. So I'll let you guys get back to your day and enjoy yourselves. And I hope you'll see you again at an event.
Yeah, hopefully. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name's Ben Robbins from the Lost World of Movie Props. I'm here today with Darren Kent. How are you doing, sir?
I'm very well, man. It's nice to see you.
Yeah, it's nice to see you too. So how are you enjoying the event today? Has it been busy for you?
It's been really good. I mean, they keep coming in drips and drabs, but it got really crazy about 15 minutes ago.
Yeah.
So it's been really, really nice. And it's obviously lovely to obviously chat to people that are fans of your work.
Yeah.
It's nice to get recognition, and it's obviously nice to be appreciated.
Yeah,
we need our massaged egos massaged every now and then, you know.
Awesome.
We're drama queens.
So you've done quite a bit. So you're in EastEnders. So
I am, yes.
Talk us what it's like to work on such an iconic show like EastEnders.
I'll be honest. I mean, a lot of actors probably try and avoid the soaps.
Mm.
I absolutely love them.
Nice.
They're my guilty pleasure. I can't help it.
Yeah.
So, and I was brought up with EastEnders.
Mm.
So I was dying to get on the show, to be honest. So it took me a while.
Yeah.
It took me a lot of other sort of roles before I could get there.
Yeah.
But the set is incredible, and the people, they're so lovely, the actors.
Yeah.
They are like a big family. And for any newcomer, as soon as you turn up, they make you feel like you've been there years.
Yeah.
You know, and it's such a pleasure to be in such an iconic show. And obviously it's only up the road from me, Elstree's not too far. And just, to have a reoccurring role in soap and to have regular work for an actor, I think we take for granted how lucky and how, grateful we are when the work comes in. So for me, I love working on EastEnders.
Awesome.
And I can't wait to go back.
So how did you get the audition? Did they find you, or did you apply for it? Or?
So I directed a series for the BBC a year and a half ago called The Break. And I happened to just drop the word that I'm a massive EastEnders fan, as you do.
Yeah.
And then the casting directors phoned me up, say about 6 to 8 weeks ago, and just said, "Look, Darren, are you too busy for EastEnders right now?" And I was like, "Never too busy for EastEnders."
Yeah.
So I looked at the role and just said, "Well, is it going to be a reoccurring, or is it just like a one-liner?" because if it was a one-liner, I'd rather sort of turn it down as it's not me being snobby, but obviously East Enders is a big deal for me, so I wanted it to be a reoccurring. So, yeah, they just said, well, at the moment, you're in a few episodes, and it should be reoccurring. So I was like, I am so up for that.
Nice.
So I loved the fact that they offered me the role. I didn't have to audition. I was very lucky.
Yeah.
And it's the role of a builder.
Nice.
Renovating yardy-bargy. Not that I look like a builder, but obviously, you know, I don't mind. If they think I can do it, I'll go with it.
Yeah.
I trust their judgment. Mm. Just don't give me a spade and ask me to mix cement. Otherwise, I'm in trouble. But yeah.
So what is it like? So how do they film on set? Is it quite fast-paced, or do you get to take your time? Like, how do they work?
It's super fast. I mean, most films, obviously, you get take after take, and you could do one scene that could last days. Mm. You know, and it's quite tedious.
Yeah.
But with EastEnders, you go there, you block the scene, so you do a quick rehearsal, and then you normally get maybe two takes.
Yeah.
And then they go, okay, we're moving on.
You're like, nice.
Oh, no, I'm kind of just getting in my stride now. So is there anything else you want me to do differently? They went, no, that's fine. We're going to do one more angle, and then we're wrapped.
Yeah.
It's like, oh. So before you know it, the scenes are over quite quick. And if you've only got one scene, it must be quite horrible.
Yeah.
Because you're thinking, what do you mean I'm going home? Like, you're just sort of meeting everyone. But obviously, I was there a few days and a few different episodes, so it allowed me to sort of see how fast-paced it is.
Yeah.
But it's, I think what blows you away is the set, because it's everything looks real.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, most times you go in a studio or in a warehouse, like Shameless. When I did Shameless, it was like a big warehouse, and you could push the walls down.
Nice.
It's like paper thin.
Yeah.
Whereas in EastEnders, you see like real houses, a real pub, real shops and laundrettes, and it's slightly shrunk.
Yeah.
So where obviously a normal road with paths is a certain width, everything's just slightly on a smaller scale. Mm. But the detail is incredible. So I found EastEnders probably one of the best sets I've been on.
Yeah.
And I've worked on some amazing sets. I mean, obviously Game of Thrones was quite incredible.
Yeah.
In terms of the set, everything was like 4D. It was crazy. But EastEnders for me was the most real.
Yeah.
It made me feel, because I'm a London boy as well. So to see all London houses and to be soaked up in that world that I was brought up in, really, because EastEnders dominated our TV and our house, was just a real privilege, and I felt really lucky to have that opportunity. So hopefully I'll be moving into Walford very soon, and I'll be running off with Janine Butcher.
Yeah.
Just don't tell my missus, and then we'll go from there.
Well, we'll see that on episode, hopefully, then, when you run off with her. So.
Well, hopefully, yeah. Hopefully they listen to this interview and then hopefully get writing.
So yeah, you just mentioned Games of Thrones. So what's your character in Games of Thrones, and what role did you do?
So in Game of Thrones, I'm like a grieving father. So basically in season 4, the dragons get out of control.
Yeah.
And everyone's coming to Daenerys to complain about what their dragons have done. Most of them are saying, you've killed my goats, my crops and stuff. And she doesn't really care. She doesn't really pay any attention.
Yeah.
But with me, I display my 10-year-old dead daughter's carcass, which her dragons have burned alive. And that's the only time that the Queen Daenerys actually takes note and thinks, my dragons have done wrong here.
Yeah.
So she locks the dragons up in season 4. Which caused outrage for the fans, because they love, obviously, a dragon.
Yeah.
So I got a few death threats after
really?
That. It's your fault the dragons are locked up. I'm like, can you hear yourself? Like, it's just a show. I said, I'm just an actor. Like, but yeah, it's crazy. The scale of the show is mental.
Yeah.
And overnight, I was getting like thousands and thousands of new fans and followers, which is lovely and overwhelming. But you do, with that comes a few haters.
Yeah.
And obviously, when you interrupt with a certain storyline, they can it can kick off a little bit. But that's good, because it's publicity,
and I'm
just doing my job. I just want to act. I don't really, you know, mind if it causes a bit of rumble or if it shakes up a show. Mm. It's always nice to be involved in a storyline. But
yeah.
So that was my role in it, in Game of Thrones.
So what was it like, obviously, seeing the sets and the props? Did you get to use a lot of props in Games of Thrones?
Apart from my dead daughter's skeleton, I'm done up in... I wear a turban.
Yeah.
I'm speaking Valyrian.
Nice.
So there's a made-up language, a real language that was made up for the show.
Yeah.
So I had to have a voice dialect coach, and I had to have people behind the camera watching my every move, every placement in my mouth, and just make sure I get all the pronunciations right.
Yeah.
So that was the hardest thing about Game of Thrones, I think, getting the dialogue and the language correct, because it isn't, a lot of people think it's gibberish.
Yeah.
People just making up stuff. It's not. It's a real language that someone's made up. So it's, but the set, is incredible. Where most film sets you go on, you have three walls a set, and the other wall is normally where the crew are and all the cables. One, Game of Thrones, everything was hidden. The crew were hidden. Everything was set.
Yeah.
So everywhere, it was like four-dimensional. It was just one of the biggest sets I've ever been on. Mm. There's balls of fire, flames, and everything. Everything was boiling hot because of real fire everywhere.
Yeah.
But that was probably the biggest set I've ever been on, and the most that blew me away, I would say.
Yeah.
Of all of them, 100%.
Nice. Because were you in Snow White as well?
I was.
So what's it like working from a TV set going into a film set? What's the differences like shooting and acting on a film set to TV?
It's a much quicker turnaround with TV.
Yeah.
You normally only get one or two takes, like in EastEnders. Also, apart from EastEnders, with something like Game of Thrones, it's more like a studio or a factory.
Yeah.
But then on Snow White and the Huntsman, I was at Pinewood Studios. Mm. So that was obviously on a much bigger scale because it's a film.
Yeah.
It was an epic film with obviously loads of names attached. Because obviously the dwarves, every dwarf was obviously a named actor.
Yeah.
So it was incredible, but it's deceiving. Mm. I mean, what you see on screen is not what I saw when I was filming. You turn up at Pinewood and you've got this massive front of a castle and you think, whoa, that is insane. It looks amazing. But then you go around the corner and it's just loads of units and green screens and stuff. And you're thinking, what is going on here? But then when you watch it, that castle is like on a moat with water. And so they put water on a green screen so that when horses gallop, you get the flicker of the water. So you learn a lot more. You learn more on film.
Yeah.
Because obviously with film, the effects are added afterwards.
Yeah.
Which is what makes it quite magical when you get to see it on the big screen.
Yeah.
But with obviously TV, what you see is what you get. So the set, the dressing is already done to make it look as real as possible.
Yeah.
But obviously, Snow White being a fantasy, mystical sort of world they created, all of them added little tweaks needed to be done in the edit.
Nice.
But Snow White was quite an eye-opener for me.
Yeah.
But it was so cold.
Was it cold?
Oh, my word. We shot in December and I'm wearing next to nothing. They like showing my skinny body off.
Yeah.
I don't know why, because I hate it, but they seem to want to see it. They want to see how emaciated I look and, malnourished.
Oh, wonderful.
So use what you got, I guess.
So obviously, you're at the event today. How did you get booked for the end? Do you want to do some little guilty plugs now? So can people book you through your social medias, or how can people get hold of you?
Yeah, they can. I mean, I have my own website.
Yeah.
So that's just www.darrenkent.com.
Yeah.
So that's how they can contact me if they wanted to, or on my social media. I'm all over social media. I've got a Darren Kent acting page on Facebook, and then my Instagram and Twitter are just Darren Paul Kent.
Awesome.
So they can always message me on there. Or via my agent, which is Carey Dodd, at Carey Dodd Associates. But I got this booking through, I've known Ross for a while. And Ross, I've done a few comic cons with Ross. And he just said, being a local boy, because I'm living in Essex at the moment.
Nice.
I'm just on Canberra Island. Sounds so exotic, doesn't it, Canberra Island? For anyone that's been there knows the truth. So Ross just said, look, if you're not busy filming, would you like to come on board and be a guest signer today? So I was like, well, I'm at the festival anyway, so I've been at the festival all weekend. I love coming to these sort of events. I was at Romford last week. I just love film. I love mixing with creatives. So, and obviously it's lovely to meet fans and obviously get a chance to speak to some people that are fans of your work. So as soon as Ross said, are you available, I said, if I'm not filming, I'm there. And luckily it didn't clash with anything, so so I'm here today, and it's been a nice turnout.
Yeah.
It's been busier than I thought, being the first year, the guinea pig year.
Yeah.
And you never really know what's going to happen. And obviously with the festival running parallel, it's nice because the Comic Con audience might now not only come to us, but they're going to go and watch some films with Paul Cartgrove, and vice versa, hopefully. Some of the guys watching the films might want to break from that and might want to sneak in and have a couple of cheeky photos of us.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Which is always a bonus.
Yeah, wonderful. Well, thank you so much for talking to me quickly.
Thank
today.
You,
been
man.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
I hope to see you again at events.
Oh, it's a pleasure, man. Lovely to see you.
Nice to see you.
Thank you very much, man. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name's Ben Robbins, and I'm here today with Matt Tyler. How are you doing, sir?
Yeah, I'm great. Thanks. Yourself?
Yeah, I'm good. Thank you. So, how are you enjoying your day today?
Yeah, it's been really good. It's been really good. It's good to come down to South End. I've never been before, so it's good to sort of see the sights.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, nice. So, obviously, we're here at the Screen Signers today. It's obviously their first event. Has it been busy so far?
Yeah, it's been good. It's been steady. hopefully you'll pick up a bit more as well.
Yeah.
I think it's a nice day outside, so hopefully we'll get a few people trickling through. So yeah, it's been good.
Brilliant. So let's talk a little bit about your career then.
Yeah.
So had you always want to be an actor growing up, or was this something you fell into?
Yeah, so it was one of those things. It was something that like I enjoyed, but I didn't sort of see it fully as like something that I wanted to do. And then sort of like when I was in school, I was good at everything, but I didn't really enjoy anything other than drama. So it was just something that I went to university, pursued it there, and then managed to get a role in Star Wars, first thing I did. So, it was kind of like fell into it, really.
Yeah. So how did you get your audition, your role in Star Wars? Talk us through that.
So, yeah, so it was a bit of an odd one. When I was in university, we had like an agency come round to like sign people up to extra work and things like that. So everyone in my year signed up, and then didn't really hear anything from them. And then I was doing a play for one of my friends. And got a text one day, basically just asking me if I was 6'8" or over. And I thought this was really oddly specific. So I genuinely thought it was my friends trying to wind me up. So I didn't text them back. And then luckily they called me and said, this is who we are. We want you to come down to London. So I was like, yeah, sure. Like, nothing to lose. So I went down and found out what it was, because they didn't tell you what it was, and was like, oh my god, texting my mum like, you'll never guess where I am.
Nice.
And then auditioned, and then got the part. So
brilliant. So obviously Star Wars was your first film, so how tall are you, because you play a Wookiee in Star Wars, don't you?
So I'm 6'8".
6'8",
so I was one of the small Wookiees.
So what's it like getting the Wookiee wardrobe, like how did they fit you for it, what does it feel like to wear? And
the fittings, that was like probably the longest part, really. We ended up having the costume made and fitted and doing all the little bits across the span of a year, essentially. So we went down, it started off with essentially like a onesie, like a black leotard thing, and then they built the costume on top of that. So we'd go in and they were showing us all the yak hair that they used, and they were like sewing that in. And then because our characters were like slaves, they were essentially supposed to be like malnourished, so we had like prosthetic knee cap things and ribs, and so it slowly, you'd see it start coming together. And then initially to wear, it was quite uncomfortable because it was quite tight. And there was one day where we went in, it was July heat, and then the prosthetics like shrank.
Nice.
So I ended up squeezing you in. But then eventually after a while, you got more used to it. So it just sort of became day to day. You got quite, it was very hot, but you got very used to it after a while.
So had you obviously seen the other Star Wars and how a Wookiee walks and talks, had you researched your character at all?
Yeah, so I had seen the other films. It was, I've done a lot of sort of movement with my course when I was at university, so there was a level of background there, but we worked with Paul Casey, who was the movement director there, so a lot of how we moved came through him and through rehearsals and just sort of going over and over and over and practicing sort of thing. I think obviously there was how Chewie moves, but we were, because we were slaves, it was a bit different. We were both slightly downtrodden, so there wasn't really a reference point to go off. It was just through the rehearsals and through Paul, essentially.
Brilliant. So talk us through like your first day on set. What was it like to be on a Star Wars set and see it all set up? And
So the first day was a bit mad. So obviously we'd been down to Pinewood a few times, but never to sort of go in the sets. It was more for costume fittings or rehearsals or different things. The very first day of going on set, obviously we'd seen the costumes quite a few times. And it was like getting costumes. They were like, oh, we're going to use you now. And obviously it's hustle and bustle of all these different sort of characters, creatures and things there. So you're sort of like, what is going on here? And then we were taken to the back lot of Pinewood to like a car park. And then you just saw this like black structure, which was all like curtains. And then they walked us along and walked us through these curtains, opened them up, and there was the Kessel Mines.
Nice.
Half the Millennium Falcon. You were just like, whoa,
that's mad.
This is cool, this. And then we just ended up doing different shots and doing some fighting scenes, and then they'd do pickup shots and all different things. So it was no 2 days were the same, but it was cool. It was very cool.
So did you get any like breaks between, obviously, to cool down? Because obviously, and you're such a furry outfit as well. So how was that sort of managed?
So we would get breaks, but it very much would depend on how the schedule of filming was going and things like that. But we had some like production assistants that were working with us, who their job was essentially to look after us, make sure we weren't dying inside the suit, and they had like these mini leaf blowers that they put in, and then we had like a hot, we had like a mesh mouth, and they had like a hole where they could put straws through for just like Ribena and stuff. And then when we weren't filming, we'd be in the little tent, so we were able to take most of the costume off and sit and sort of cool down. So there was, we weren't sort of sweltering all day.
Yeah. So did you go to the cinema to watch yourself on the big screen? Were you happy watching yourself?
Yeah. There was a premiere down in London, so I took my mum.
Nice.
A proud moment for her.
Yeah.
So we went to watch it down there, and it was amazing, yeah, because obviously we'd spent so long. It had been 2 years since first audition and getting that text.
Oh, wow, two years.
So it was quite a long process. Mm. And when I was going down, when I first got the job, I didn't drive. So I was coming down from Liverpool, and I'd get a coach at midnight, six-hour coach down. Yeah. And then I'd go from Victoria Coach Station all the way across to Slough. So I was essentially doing about 16 hours of travelling just to do this and different things. So when it was a long, arduous process, very enjoyable. And it was just the culmination of all of that, and seeing it come together was amazing.
Yeah, brilliant. So should we do a few little guilty plugs quickly?
Yeah, of course.
So obviously you were booked to be here today. Can people just contact you privately through your social medias, or can people get hold of you to book you for events?
Yeah, just through social media mainly. That's I haven't really got any pages or anything like that. It's just my personal social medias and things like that.
So what's your, have you got Instagram, Facebook and all that?
Yeah, I've got Instagram. I don't post very often.
No, that's cool.
I'm not an influencer, but I've got Instagram. I think my handle is, I think it's mtyler1805. I'll double check. I genuinely don't use Instagram that often. I'm like an old man. It is mtyler1805.
Cool. Yeah, perfect. Yeah, so if anyone wants to book you, by all means, go through Instagram.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah.
Cool.
Amazing.
Yeah. So I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.
Yeah.
And hope you enjoy meeting the fans. And obviously, COVID sort of spread out a bit more now. Yeah, we can sort of relax and actually meet fans a bit more again and do pictures and autographs.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah.
Perfect. Awesome. Thanks so much.
Lovely. We're here.